thought of such things in his hidden house, and he pondered on ways to have his son reared away from Iolcus and the dread and the power of King Peleus. He had for a friend one who was the wisest of all creatures, Chiron the centaur. Chiron, who was happy with him and had seen the centaur hunt with his great bow and his great spears. And Aeson knew a way that one might come to him. Chiron himself had told him of the way. Now there was a slave in his house who had been a huntsman, and who knew all the ways of the mountain Pelion. Aeson talked with this slave one day, and after he had talked with him, he sat for a long time over the cradle of his sleeping infant. And then he spoke to Alcimede, his wife, telling her of a parting that made her weep. That evening the slave came in, and Aeson took the child from the arms of the mournful-eyed mother and put him in the slave's arms. Also he gave him a horn and a ring with a great ruby in it and mystic images engraved on its gold. Then, when the ways were dark, the slave mounted a horse, and with the child in his arms rode through the city that King Peleus ruled over. In the morning he came to that mountain that is covered with forest, the mountain Peleus. And that evening he came back to the village and to Aeson's hidden house, and he told his master how he had prospered. Aeson was content thereafter, although he was lonely, and although his wife was lonely in their childlessness. But the time came when they rejoiced that their child had been sent into an unreachable place. For messengers from King Peleus came inquiring about the boy. They told the king's messengers that the child had strayed off from his nurse, and that whether he had been slain by a wild beast, or had been drowned in the swift river Anaurus, they did not know. The years went by, and Peleus felt secure upon the throne he had taken from his brother. Once he sent to the oracle of the gods to ask of it whether he should be fearful of anything. What the oracle answered was this, that King Peleus had but one thing to dread, the coming of a half-shod man. The centaur nourished the child Jason on roots and fruits and honey. For shelter, they had a great cave that Chiron had lived in for numberless years. When he had grown big enough to leave the cave, Chiron would let Jason mount on his back. With the child holding on to his great mane, he would trot gently through the ways of the forest. Jason began to know the creatures of the forest and their haunts. Sometimes Chiron would bring his great bow with him. Then Jason on his back would hold the quiver and would hand him the arrows. The centaur would let the boy see him kill with a single arrow the bear, the boar, or the deer. And soon Jason, running beside him, hunted too. No heroes were ever better trained than those whose childhood and youth had been spent with Chiron, the king centaur. He made them more swift of foot than any other of the children of men. He made them stronger and more ready with the spear and bow. Jason was trained by Chiron as Heracles just before him had been trained, and as Achilles' gods. Once, when they were hunting together, Jason saw a form at the end of an alley of trees. The form of a woman it was, of a woman who had on her head a shining crown. Never had Jason dreamt of seeing a form so wondrous. Not very near did he come, but he thought he knew that the woman smiled upon him. She was seen no more, and Jason knew that he had looked upon one of the immortal goddesses. All day Jason was filled with thought of her whom he had seen. At night, when the stars were out, and when they were seated outside the cave, Chiron and Jason talked together, and Chiron told the youth that she whom he had seen was none other than Hera, the wife of Zeus, who had for his father Aeson and for himself an especial friendliness. So Jason grew up upon the mountain and in the forest fastnesses. When he had reached his full height and had shown himself swift in the hunt and strong with the spear and bow, Chiron told him that the time had come when he should go back to the world of men and make his name famous by the doing of great deeds. And when Chiron told him about his father Aeson, about how he had been thrust out of the kingship by Peleus, his uncle, a great longing came upon Jason to see his father, and a fierce anger grew up in his heart against Peleus. Then the time came when he bade goodbye to Chiron, his great instructor, and the time came when he went from the centaur's cave for the last time, and went through the wooded ways and down the side of the mountain Pelion. He came to the river, to the swift Anaurus, and he found it high in flood. The stones by which one might cross were almost all washed over. Far apart did they seem in the flood. left him down upon the bank. As she was lifting him down, one of his feet touched the water. The swift current swept away a sandal. He stood on the bank, knowing that she who had carried him across the river had strength from the gods. He looked upon her, and behold, she was transformed. Instead of an old woman, there stood before him one who had on a golden robe and a shining crown. Around her was a wondrous light, the light of the sun when it is most golden. Then Jason knew that she who had carried him across the broad Anorus was the goddess whom he had seen in the ways of the forest, Hera, great Zeus's wife. "Go into Iolcus, Jason," said great Hera to him. "Go into Iolcus, and in whatever chance doth befall thee, act as one who has the eyes of the immortals upon him." She spoke, and she was seen no more. Then Jason went on his way to the city that Cretheus, his grandfather, had founded, and that his father Aeson had once ruled over. He came into that city, a tall, great-limbed, unknown youth, dressed in a strange fashion, and having but one sandal on. End of section one. Part one, chapter two, King Peleus. That day King Peleus, walking through the streets of his city, saw coming toward him a youth who was half-shod. He remembered the words of the oracle that bade him beware of a half-shod man, and straightway he gave orders to his guards to lay hands upon the youth. But the guards wavered when they went toward him, for there was something about the youth that put them in awe of him. He came with the guards, however, and he stood before the king's judgment seat. Fearfully did Peleus look upon him, but not fearfully did the youth look upon the king. With head lifted high, he cried out, "Thou art Peleus, but I do not salute thee as king. Know that I am Jason, the son of Aeson, from whom thou hast taken the throne and scepter that were rightfully his." King Peleus looked to his guards. He would have given them a sign to destroy the youth's life with their spears, but behind his guards he saw a threatening multitude, the dwellers of the city of Iolcus. They gathered around, and Peleus knew that he had become more and more hated by them. And from the multitude a cry went up, "Aeson! Aeson! May Aeson come back to us! Jason, son of Aeson! May nothing evil befall thee, brave youth!" Then Peleus knew that the youth might not be slain. He bent his head while he plotted against him in his heart. Then he raised his eyes, and looking upon Jason, he said, "O goodly youth, it well may be that thou art the son of Aeson, my brother. I am well pleased to see thee here. I have had hopes that I might be friends with Aeson, and thy coming here may be the means to the renewal of our friendship. We two brothers may come together again. I will send for thy father now, and he will be brought to meet me in my royal palace. Go with my guards and with this rejoicing people, and in a little while thou and I and thy father Aeson will sit at a feast of friends." So Peleus said, and Jason went with the guards and the crowd of people, and he came to the palace of the king, and he was brought within. The maids led him to the bath and gave him new robes to wear. Dressed in these, Jason looked handsome indeed. But all that while King Peleus remained on his judgment seat with his crowned head bent down. When he raised his head, his dark brows were gathered together, and his thin lips were very close. He looked to the swords and spears of his guards, and he made a sign to the men to stand close to him. Then he left the judgment seat, and he went to the palace. End of section two. Part one, chapter three, the golden fleece. They brought Jason into a hall where Aeson, his father, waited. Very strange did this old and grave-looking man appear to him. But when Aeson spoke, Jason remembered, even without the sight of the ruby ring, the tone of his father's voice, and he clasped him to him. And his father knew him, even without the sight of the ruby ring which Jason had upon his finger. Then the young man began to tell of the centaur, and of his life upon the mountain Peleus. As they were speaking together, Peleus came to where they stood, Peleus in the purple robe of a king, and with the crown upon his head. Aeson tightly clasped Jason, as if he had become fearful for his son. Peleus smilingly took the hand of the young man, and the hand of his brother, and he bade them both welcome to his palace. Hasty were brought to the tables. He ate and drank, and his eyes swelled. sons would treat him as he had treated Heaven, his father. So, when another child was born to him and his wife Rhea, he commanded that the child be given to him, so that he might swallow him. But Rhea wrapped a great stone in swaddling clothes, and gave the stone to Cronus. And Cronus swallowed the stone, thinking to swallow his latest born child. That child was Zeus. Earth took Zeus and hid him in a deep cave, and those who minded and nursed the child beat upon drums so that his cries might not be heard. His nurse was Adrestia. When he was able to play, she gave him a ball to play with. All of gold was the ball, with a dark blue spiral around it. When the boy Zeus would play with this ball, it would make a track across the sky, flaming like a star. Hyperion, the Titan god, wed Thea, the Titan goddess, and their children were Hellas, the bright sun, and Selene, the clear moon. And Coeus wed Phoebe, and their children were Leto, who was kind to gods and men, and Asteria of happy name, and Hecate, whom Zeus honored above all. Now the gods who were the children of Cronus and Rhea went up into the mountain Olympus, and there they built their shining palaces. But the Titan gods who were born of heaven and earth went up to the mountain Othrys, and there they had their thrones. Darkness lay upon us. Our minds are fixed to aid you in the war against the Titan gods. So the hundred-armed giants said, and thereupon Zeus went and he gathered around him all who were born of Cronus and Rhea. Cronus himself hid from Zeus. Then the giants, with their 50 heads growing from their shoulders and their 100 hands, went forth against the Titan gods. The boundless sea rang terribly, and the earth crashed loudly. Wide heaven was shaken and groaned, and high Olympus reeled from its foundation. Holding huge rocks in their hands, the giants attacked the Titan gods. Then Zeus entered the war. He hurled the lightning. The bolts flew thick and fast from his strong hand, with thunder and lightning and flame. The earth crashed around in burning, the forests crackled with fire, the ocean seethed, and hot flames wrapped the earth-born titans all around. 300 rocks, one upon another, did Cottus, Briareus, and Gyas hurl upon the titans. And when their ranks were broken, the giants seized upon them and held them for Zeus. But some of the titan gods, seeing that strife for them was vain, went over to the side of Zeus. These Zeus became friendly with, but the other titans he bound in chains, and he hurled them down to Tartarus. As far as earth is from heaven, so is Tartarus from earth. A brazen anvil falling down from heaven to earth 9 days and 9 nights would reach the earth upon the 10th day. And again, a brazen anvil falling from earth 9 days and 9 nights would reach Tartarus upon the 10th night. Around Tartarus runs a fence of bronze, and night spreads in a triple line all about it, as a necklace circles the neck. There Zeus imprisoned the Titan gods who had fought against him. They are hidden in the misty gloom, in a dank place, at the ends of the earth. And they may not go out, for Poseidon fixed gates of bronze upon their prison, and a wall runs all round it. There Cottus, Briareus, and Gyas stay, guarding them. And there, too, is the home of night. Night and day meet each other at that place, as they pass a threshold of bronze. They draw near, and they greet one another, but the house never holds them both together, for while one is about to go down into the house, the other is leaving through the door. One holds light in her hand, and the other holds in her arms sleep. There the children of dark night have their dwellings, sleep and death his brother. The sun never shines upon these two. Sleep may roam over the wide earth, and come upon the sea, and he is kindly to men. But death is not kindly, and whoever he seizes upon, him he holds fast. There, too, stands the hall of the lord of the underworld, Aidoneus, the brother of Zeus. Zeus gave him the underworld to be his dominion when he shared amongst the Olympians the world that Cronus had ruled over. A fearful hound guards the hall of Aidoneus. Cerberus he is called. He has 3 heads. On those who go within that hall, Cerberus spawns, but on those who would come out of it, he springs and would devour him. Not all the Titans did Zeus send down to Tartarus. Those of them who had wisdom joined him, and by their wisdom Zeus was able to overcome Cronus. Then Cronus went to live with the friendly Titan gods, while Zeus reigned over Olympus, becoming the ruler of gods and men. that the Argonauts came nigh to and went past need not be told. Melibuia, where they escaped a stormy beach. Homily, from where they were able to look on Ossa and holy Olympus. Lemnos, the island that they were to return to. The unnamed country where the earth-born men abide, each having six arms, two growing from his shoulders, and four fitting close to his terrible sides. And then the mountain of the bears, where they climbed to make sacrifice there to Rhea, the mighty mother of the gods. Afterward, for a whole day, no wind blew, and the sail of the Argo hung slack. But the heroes swore to each other that they would make their ship go as swiftly as if the storm-footed steeds of Poseidon were racing to overtake her. Mightily they labored at the oars, and no one would be the first to leave his rower's bench. And then, just as the breeze of the evening came up, and just as the rest of the heroes were leaning back, spent with their labor, the oar that Heracles still pulled at broke, and half of it was carried away by the waves. Heracles sat there in ill humor, for he did not know what to do with his unlaboring hands. All through the night they went on with a good breeze filling their sails, and next day they came to the mouth of the river Cius. There they landed so that Heracles might get himself an oar. No sooner did they set their feet upon the shore than the hero went off into the forest to pull up a tree that might shape into an oar. Where they had landed was near to the country of the Bebrycians, a rude people whose king was named Amycus. Now while Heracles was away from them, this king came with his followers, huge, rude men, all armed with clubs, down to where the Argonauts were lighting their fires on the beach. He did not greet them courteously, asking them what manner of men they were and whither they were bound, nor did he offer them hospitality. Instead, he shouted at them insolently, "Listen to something that you rovers had better know. I am Amycus, and any stranger that comes to this land has to get into a boxing bout with me. That's the law that I have laid down. Unless you have one amongst you who can stand up to me, you won't be let go back to your ship. If you don't heed my law, look out, for something's going to happen to you." So he shouted, that insolent king, and his followers raised their clubs and growled approval of what their master said. But the Argonauts were not dismayed at the words of Amycus. One of them stepped toward the Bebrycian. He was Polydeuces, good at boxing. "Offer us no violence, king," said Polydeuces. "We are ready to obey the law that you have laid down. Willingly do I take up your challenge, and I will box about with you." The Argonauts cheered when they saw Polydeuces, the good boxer, step forward, and when they heard what he had to say. Amycus turned and shouted to his followers, and one of them brought up two pairs of boxing gauntlets, of rough cowhide they were. The Argonauts feared that Polydeuces' hands might have been made numb with pulling at the oar, and some of them went to him and took his hands and rubbed them to make them supple. Others took from off his shoulders his beautifully colored mantle. Amycus straightway put on his gauntlets and threw off his mantle. He stood there amongst his followers with his great arms crossed, glowering at the Argonauts as a wild beast might glower. And when the two faced each other, Amycus seemed like one of the earth-born men, dark and hugely shaped, while Helen's brother stood there light and beautiful. Polydeuces was like that star whose beams are lovely at eventide. Like the wave that breaks over a ship and gives the sailors no respite, Amycus came on at Polydeuces. He pushed in upon him, thinking to bear him down and overwhelm him. But as the skillful steersman keeps the ship from being overwhelmed by the monstrous wave, so Polydeuces, all skill and lightness, baffled the rushes of Amycus. At last, Amycus, standing on the tips of his toes and rising high above him, tried to bring down his great fist upon the head of Polydeuces. The hero swung aside and took the blow on his shoulder. Then he struck his blow. It was a strong one, and under it the king of the Bebrycians staggered and fell down. "You see," said Polydeuces, "that we keep your law." The Argonauts shouted, but the rude Bebrycians raised their clubs to rush upon them. Then would the heroes have been hard-pressed and forced, perhaps, to get back to the Argo. But suddenly Heracles appeared amongst them, coming up from the forest. He carried a pine tree in his hands with all its branches still upon it. And seeing this mighty-statured man appear with the great tree in his hands, the Bebrycians hurried off, carrying their fallen king with them. smiled at every glance that was given him, at every word that was said to him. Now as he walked through the flowering grasses with his knees bare, and with the bright vessel swinging in his hand, he looked most lovely. Heracles had brought the boy with him from the country of Dryopians. He would have him sit beside him on the bench of the Argo, and the ill humors that often came upon him would go at the words and smile of Hylas. Now the spring that Hylas was going towards was called Peggy, and it was haunted by the nymphs. They were dancing around it when they heard Hylas singing. They stole off softly to watch him. Hidden behind trees, the nymphs saw the boy come near, and they felt such love for him that they thought they could never let him go from their sight. They stole back to their spring, and they sank down below its clear surface. Then came Hylas singing a song that he had heard from his mother. He bent down to the spring, and the brimming water flowed into the sounding bronze of the pitcher. Then hands came out of the water. One of the nymphs caught Hylas by the elbow, another put her arms around his neck, another took the hand that held the vessel of bronze. The pitcher sank down to the depths of the spring. The hands of the nymphs clasped Hylas tighter, tighter. The water bubbled around him as they drew him down, 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 and into the cold and glimmering cave where they live. There Hylas stayed. But although the nymphs kissed him and sang to him and showed him lovely things, Hylas was not content to be there. Where the Argonauts were, the fires burned, the moon arose, and still Hylas did not return. Then they began to fear lest a wild beast had destroyed the boy. One went to Heracles and told him that young Hylas had not come back, and that they were fearful for him. Heracles flung down the pine tree that he was fashioning into an oar, and he dashed along the way that Hylas had gone as if a gadfly was stinging him. "Hylas! Hylas!" he cried. But Hylas, in the cold and glimmering cave that the nymphs had drawn him into, did not hear the call of his friend Heracles. All the Argonauts went searching, calling as they went through the island, "Hylas! Hylas! Hylas!" But only their own calls came back to them. The morning star came up, and Tiphys, the steersman, called to them from the Argo. And when they came to the ship, Tiphys told them that they would have to go aboard and make ready to sail from that place. They called to Heracles, and Heracles at last came down to the ship. They spoke to him, saying that they would have to sail away. Heracles would not go on board. "I will not leave this island," he said, "until I find young Hylas or learn what has happened to him." Then Jason arose to give the command to depart. But before the words were said, Telamon stood up and faced him. "Jason," he said angrily, "you do not bid Heracles come on board, and you would have the Argo leave without him. You would leave Heracles here, so that he may not be with us on the quest, where his glory might overshadow your glory, Jason." Jason said no word, but he sat back on his bench with his head bowed. And then, even as Telamon said these angry words, a strange figure rose up out of the waves of the sea. It was the figure of a man, wrinkled and old, with seaweed in his beard and his hair. There was a majesty about him, and the Argonauts all knew that this was one of the immortals. He was Nereus, the Ancient One of the Sea. "To Heracles and to you, the rest of the Argonauts, I have a thing to say," said the Ancient One, Nereus. "Know first that Hylas has been taken by the nymphs who love him, and who think to win his love, and that he will stay forever with them in their cold and glimmering cave. For Hylas, seek no more. And to you, Heracles, I will say this. Go aboard the Argo again. The ship will take you to where a great labor awaits you, and which, in accomplishing, you will work out the will of Zeus upon their ankles." It was a while before he turned his face from them. Then he spoke to Jason and said, "You have come to have counsel with one who has the wisdom of the gods. Others before you have come for such counsel, but seeing the misery that is visible upon me, they went without asking for counsel. I would strive to hold you here for a while. Stay, and have sight of the misery the gods visit upon those who would be as wise as they. And when you have seen the thing that is wont to befall me, it may be that help will come from you for me." Then Phineas, the blind king, left them, and after a while the heroes were brought into a great hall, and they were invited to rest themselves there while a banquet was being prepared for them. The hall was richly adorned, but it looked to the heroes as if it had known strange happenings. Rich hangings were strewn upon the ground, an ivory chair was overturned, and the dais where the king sat had stains upon it. The servants that had the wings and claws of birds and the heads of women. Black hair and gray feathers were mixed upon them. They had red eyes, and streaks of blood were upon their breasts and wings. And as the king raised the food to his mouth, they flew at him and buffeted his head with their wings and snatched the food from his hands. Then they devoured or scattered what was upon the table, and all the time they screamed and laughed and mocked. Ah, now you see, Phineas panted, what it is to have wisdom equal to the wisdom of the gods. Now ye all see my misery. Never do I strive to put food to my lips, but these foul things, the harpies, the snatchers, swoop down and scatter or devour what I would eat. Crumbs they leave me that my life might not altogether go from me, but these crumbs they make foul to my taste and to my smell. And one of the harpies perched herself on the back of the king's throne and looked upon the heroes with red eyes. Ha! She screamed. You bring armed men into a feasting hall, thinking to scare us away. Never, Phineas, can you scare us from you. Always you will have us, the snatchers, beside you, and you would still your ache of hunger. What can these men do against us who are winged and who can travel through the ways of the air? So said the unsightly harpy, and the heroes drew together, made fearful by these awful shapes. All drew back, except Zetes and Calais, the sons of the north wind. They laid their hands upon their swords. The wings on their shoulders spread out, and the wings at their heels trembled. Phineas the king leaned forward and panted. By the wisdom I have, I know that there are two amongst you who can save me. Oh, make haste to help me, ye who can help me, and I will give ye the counsel that you Argonauts have come to me for. And besides, I will load down your ship with treasure and costly stuffs. Oh, make haste, ye who can help me. Hearing the king speak like this, the harpies gathered together and gnashed their teeth and chattered to one another. Then, seeing Zetes and Calais with their hands upon their swords, they rose up on their wings and flew through the wide doors of the hall. The king cried out to Zetes and Calais, but the sons of the north wind had already risen with their wings, and they were after the harpies, their bright swords in their hands. On flew the harpies, screeching and gnashing their teeth in anger and dismay, for now they felt that they might be driven from Salmydessus, where they had had such royal feasts. They rose high in the air and flew out toward the sea. But high as the harpies rose, the sons of the north wind rose higher. The harpies cried pitiful cries as they flew on, but Zetes and Calais felt no pity for them, for they knew that these dread snatchers with the stains of blood upon their breasts and wings had shown pity neither to Phineas nor to any other. On they flew until they came to the island that is called the Floating Island. There the harpies sank down with wearied wings. Zetes and Calais were upon them now, and they would have cut them to pieces with their bright swords, if the messenger of Zeus, Iris, with the golden wings, had not come between. Forbear to slay the harpies, sons of Boreas, cried Iris warningly. Forbear to slay the harpies that are the hounds of Zeus. Let them cower here and hide themselves. And I, who come from Zeus, will swear the oath that the gods most dread, that they will never again come to Salmydessus to trouble Phineas the king. The heroes yielded to the words of Iris. She took the oath that the gods most dread, the oath by the water of Styx, that never again would the harpies show themselves to Phineas. Then Zetes and Calais turned back toward the city of Salmydessus. The island that they drove the harpies to had been called the Floating Island, but thereafter it was called the Island of Turning.